بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه وسلم تسليما كثيرا أما بعد. Continue from where we left in our previous class, studying the hadith of Uthman ibn Affan رضي الله عنه في صفة وضوء النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, studying the hadith of Uthman with regards to the description of the wudu, the ablution of the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. We read again the hadith عن حمران مولى عثمان بن عفان رضي الله عنه. What is the meaning of مولى؟ حمران, who is that؟ وما معنى مولى؟ Freed slave. نعم. المعتق. المعتق. This مولى here is the معتق. وعثمان, he is the معتق. He is the معتق, the one who freed him. So حمران, he was a freed slave. نعم. Who freed him? عثمان رضي الله عنه. رضي الله عنه. He says, حمران, he said, أنه رأى عثمان رضي الله عنه دعا بوضوء. That he saw Uthman call for the water of wudu. فَأَفْرَغَ عَلَى يَدَيْهِ مِنْ إِنَائِهِ. So he poured it out. He poured out the water from the vessel onto his hands. فَغَسَلَهُمَا ثَلَاثَ مَرَّاتٍ. And he washed his hands three times. What's the ruling of this washing here? Huh? Sunnah. Sunnah. لَيْسَتْ وَاجِبَةً. This is not from the pillars of wudu. This is a sunnah. Naam, the purpose of this, the wisdom for this, cleaning the hands, so that whenever he brings, or when he puts his hand in the water, it's clean. Whenever he brings the water with his hands to his mouth, and his nose, and his face, and his hands, and his head, so on and so forth, it's clean. The hands are clean, and it's bringing clean water. Naam. So this is a sunnah. Naam. ثم أدخل يمينه في الوضوء. Then he put his right hand in the water of ablution. ثم تمضمض واستنشق واستنثر. He didn't mention the time here. We remember the name. We remember the meanings of these words. صح. Everybody was on the same page. Alhamdulillah. ثم تمضمض واستنشق واستنثر. In the hadith of Uthman, it doesn't mention how many times he did that, nor does it mention the kayfiyyah, or the description of the مضمض واستنشق, or what is المضمض والاستنشاق والاستنثار. But the next narration will clarify, inshallah, how that will be. So then he said, ثم غسل وجهه ثلاثا. Then he washed his face three times. Now, what is the ruling on the مضمض and the استنشاق? Min al-wajh, it's from the face. What's the ruling of the face? It's wajib. The face is an obligation to wash it. The face is an obligation to wash it. So then that means also the madmada and the istinshaq is obligatory. If somebody made wudu, he didn't make madmada. What do we say for his wudu? Go make wudu again. He didn't make istinshaq. He made madmada, but he didn't make istinshaq. He has to go and make it again. We've seen the evidences and the proof from the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the clarification of that. These narrations here, particularly that the author mentions, that are muttafaq alayha. These two here that are agreed upon by Bukhari and Muslim from the most authentic of the narrations of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam with regards to the description of wudu, along with other narrations. These ahadith of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they clarify the details of the wudu. They clarify that which was mentioned in general in the Qur'an, in the sifa of the wudu and ayatul wudu, which is mentioned generally, as we have seen in the previous classes. These here, they clarify the details of that. The details of that. So he washed his hands three times, and then he put his hand in the wudu, and then he made madmada, what is tinshaq, what is tinthar. Then he washed his face three times. وَيَدَيْهِ إِلَى الْمِرْفَقَيْنِ ثَلَاثًا. And his hands into the elbows three times. His hands into the elbows three times. ثُمَّ مَسَحَ بِرَأْسِهِ. Then he wiped his head. This is where we stopped in our previous class. What comes along with wiping the head? ثُمَّ مَسَحَ بِرَأْسِهِ. The ears that come along with the head. صح؟ الْعُذُنَانِ مِنْ الرَّأْسِ. From the hadith of Abi Umam رضي الله عنه, الْعُذُنَانِ من الرأس. There was another benefit from that hadith, the hadith of Abi Umamah radiallahu anhu fi Jami' Tirmidhi, that came along with that narration. Something else mentioned that it's not obligatory, but it's from the sunnah. It's with regards to the eyes. أها الماق هنا the الماق كان وكان يمسح الماقين. الماق is the place where in between the eye and the nose at the top. What is that place called right there in English? Huh? In الماق where right in the corner of the eye. In the corner of the eye, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he washed his face, he would wipe that part there. He will wipe that part there to make sure the water came into that place in between the nose, the top of the nose and the eye. That's called the maq. وَكَانَ يَمْسِحُ الْمَعْقَيْنِ. This is from the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, making sure the water gets to the entire body part. Now, but here with the hadith here, he said الْأُذُنَانِ مِنْ الرَّأْسِ, that the ears are from the head. Now, so also we've seen how are the ears washed? Or they're wiped, excuse me, not washed, they're wiped. To be specific. Which fingers? What's that finger called?
Pointer.
Huh? Pointer fingers in Arabic. We learned two names of them yesterday. As-sabbaha, as-sabbaha, as-sabbahatu, as-sabbahatu. Why is it called as-sabbaha? Because a person yusabbihu biha, and we have to shahad. Naam? And make tasbih. And then the other name? As-sababa. Yusabbu biha. Like the sab is a curse, calling people names. You're this and you're that, like this. They said they call this one the sababa, because a person sometimes they use it like that whenever they are doing that action. Now, so in any case, this is the one that he used. It came in the hadith. Thumma masaha bi rasihi wa wada'a aw adkhala isba'aini as-sabahataini fi udhunayhi wa masaha bi. What are these called? Thumb, yeah, sah, in Arabic, one of them, ibham, it's called ibham. Naam, wa masaha bi ibhamayhi zahira udhunayhi. Masaha bi ibhamayhi zahira udhunayhi, like this. So that's the kayfiyah of the wiping of the ears. Come in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is in the hadith of Abdullah ibn Amr. Naam, there are certain companions that have narrated specifically the narrations with regards to the wudu of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, from them Uthman, also from them Ali, and also from them Abdullah ibn Amr, and also from them Abdullah ibn Zayd ibn Asim radiyallahu anhum jameen, and other than them, but these are some of the ones that are the hadith that are well known, narrated by these companions. May Allah be pleased with all of them. So this is how to wash the head and the ears come the same time. Also, it's beneficial for a believer to know with regards to this, that he takes new water. He doesn't wash his hands and his elbows and then do the head with the same water. Rather, he takes new water to wipe the head. He takes new water. And the methodology of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and what is correct, and Allah knows best, is that every body part, one takes water for each body part. Every body part, he takes water for that body part. He doesn't take one and then wash all of his hands like this, or he'll wipe his arms and then his head. Rather, wash his arms and hands, and then he'll take water and wipe his head and ears. And then he'll take water and wash his feet in this manner like this. So he said here, ثُمَّ مَسَحَ بِرَأْسِهِ ثُمَّ غَسَلَ كِلْتَ رِجْلَيْهِ ثَلَاثًا. Then he washed both of his feet three times. We know that it's not mentioned here, but in the ayat of wudu, it mentioned the ila al-ka'bain, to the ankles, meaning including the ankles. And then he mentioned the narration that he saw the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam make the wudu just like this. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told him, whoever makes wudu just like this, and then he prays two rak'ah, then all of his previous sins will be forgiven. Also in this narration, there is another, so we see the obligations of wudu. There are also some of the sunan of wudu being mentioned here, and that is whenever he said he washed the hands three times, that sunnah. Also whenever he washed the face three times, the first washing is fard, a wajib, it's an obligation. The other two washings are sunnah, it's the sunnah. The first one is a must, the other two is a sunnah, this is here. Also, and also we see the tartib is mentioned in this hadith, the order that it came in. So the order that it came in is in accordance with the order of the Qur'an. Also, there's a linguistic benefit that indicates that there's tartib in this hadith. What is it? At-tartib, also muwarat. It could be in the same benefit, actually. Barakallahu fiqh, naam. From a linguistics perspective, where's it at? He said here. In the ayah, there's a proof. Also, a supporting proof in the hadith. Naam. فَأَفْرَغَ عَلَى يَدَيْهِ مِنْ إِنَائِهِ فَغَسَلَهُمَا ثَلَاثَ مَرَاتٍ ثُمَّ أَدْخَلَ يَمِينُهُ فِي الْوَضُوءِ ثُمَّ تَمَدْمَضَ وَاسْتَنْشَقَ وَاسْتَنْفَرَ ثُمَّ غسل وجهه ثلاثا ويديه إلى المرفقين ثلاثا ثم مسح برأسه ثم غسل into the hadith. What's the proof? ثم تفيد الترتيب. نعم والتراخي. This word ثم, it means that there is arrangement. If he said wa using the wow and this, this does not indicate that there's tartib. For example, in the Arabic language, if it said, دَخَلَ زَيْدٌ وَعَمْرٌ, we don't know who entered first. Maybe Amr entered first. دَخَلَ زَيْدٌ وَعَمْرٌ, Zayd and Amr entered. Or we could say, دَخَلَ عَمْرٌ وَزَيْدٌ. This sentence doesn't indicate in the Arabic language which one entered first. But if one said in the Arabic language, دَخَلَ زَيْدٌ ثُمَّ عَمْرٌ, now we know that Zayd entered first. Now we know that because of thumma. This is the Arabic language. So they say, al-waw tufiru mutlaq al-jama'. This just indicates that this action is being carried together. Not any tartib or any arrangement. But here they have the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, Humran, he's describing this. He said, thumma, like this. And this is how it goes. There's tartib. Naam, and also, there must be muwarat. From the benefits of this hadith is that Uthman, he taught radiallahu anhu with action. He taught by action and by showing the proper manner to make wudu. Like he showed him by performing it for him. And also from the benefits of this hadith is that the legislation of the two rak'ah of al-wudu. The two rak'ah of al-wudu. Whenever he mentioned here, this is legislated for a believer if he makes wudu to go pray to rak'ah. It's called rak'ata al-wudu. It's known like this. And this is legislated. And also the virtue of that, the one who makes those two rak'ah. And he does not talk to himself. لا يحدث نفسه فيهما. He doesn't talk to himself. Meaning the ulama, they say, any meaning, لا يسترسل في حديث الناس. He doesn't just go off like this. Meaning this is indication that he has khushu'. And if something comes to his mind, he pushes it away. Like this. And doesn't mean the whole time. And he is absolutely focused rather. But if it comes to him, he doesn't fall into it. If something crosses his mind outside of the salat, the whispers of shaitan or even his own soul, he's talking to himself, he would push that away. And he will keep going like this and completing the prayer. And inshallah, he will have that reward that his sins will be forgiven. The ulama, they clarify though that the intent from the sins here are the minor sins. غُفِرَ لَهُ مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ ذَمِّهِ يعني مِنَ السَّغَائِرِ, from the minor sins. As for the major sins, what is well known with the position of the ulama is that the major sins, they are only forgiven by tawbah. Tawbah, there must be tawbah. There must be tawbah. As for whenever Allah mentions that the sins are being removed, so on and so forth, by actions, for example, the salawat al-khams, وَرَمَضَانِ إِلَى رَمَضَانِ وَالْعُمْرَ إِلَى عُمْرَ كَفَّارَةٌ لِمَا بَيْنَهُمَّ. Afwan kafaratun lima baynahunna. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he mentioned from the five daily prayers, one to the next, and from Ramadan to the next Ramadan, in one narration from min Jumu'ah ila Jumu'ah, from one Jumu'ah to the next, from Umrah to Umrah, like this has come in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said they are expiations. These expiate the sins that occur between them. And then in the end of this narration, he said, "Majtunibat al-kabair." So long as the major sins are stayed away from. So these great actions of worship, like the obligatory salat, from prayer to prayer, from Jumu'ah to Jumu'ah, from Umrah to Umrah, Ramadan to Ramadan, these will be a means for expiating the sins so long as the major sins are avoided. So long as the major sins are avoided. Naam, so the ulama, they mentioned based upon this, that these actions of good deeds that expiate the sins that they expiate, they are the minor sins. They're the minor sins. As for the major sins, then these are only expiated by sincere tawbah and repentance to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sincere tawbah and repentance to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The next narration, we see The author, he mentions an Amr ibn Yahya al-Mazini. An Amr ibn Yahya al-Mazini. An Abihi. Qala shahidtu Amr ibn Abi Hassan. Sa'ala Abdullah ibn Zayd. An wudu an Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This narration is from Amr ibn Yahya al-Mazini. He said he asked his father. Who's that? Yahya al-Mazini. Naam, Yahya al-Mazini. Amr ibn Yahya, he asked his father Yahya al-Mazini. Naam, he said that he witnessed his father. His father witnessed Amr ibn Abi Hassan ask Abdullah ibn Zayd. Abdullah ibn Zayd, one of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This man, he witnessed another man, Amr ibn Abi Hassan, ask Abdullah ibn Zayd. So we have one person witnessing, another person asking a companion. And he's the one narrating the narration. Indication of the diligence that they would have to learn the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and to ask the people of knowledge. And then likewise to narrate and to convey the information that they have found and that they have learned from the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So they're asking one of the companions about the wudu of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So here we have the first narration was the narration of Uthman. This is the narration of Abdullah ibn Zayd ibn Asim radiallahu anhu. He said that he was asked. He was asked about wudu, another companion. So what did he do? فَدَعَ بِتَوْرٍ مِّن مَّاءٍ فَدَعَ بِتَوْرٍ مِّن مَّاءٍ. So he called for a tawr, is a small vessel of water. This is what he didn't teach them again. He's teaching them here again. How? By application. By application. So he called like Uthman did. What did he do? دَعَ بِوَضُو. Uthman, دَعَ بِوَضُو. Here, Zayd radiallahu anhu, دَعَ بِتَوْرٍ مِّن مَّاءٍ. يعني بِالْوَضُو. He called for the water. فَتَوَضَّأَ لَهُمْ وُضُوءَ النَّبِي صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. So he made the wudu of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم for them. So he is going to show them. You want to know how the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم made wudu? This is how you do it. Look, this, I will perform it for you, in front of you. So now he describes it, رضي الله عنه. فَأَكْثَأَ عَلَى يَدَيْهِ مِنَ التَّوْرِ. So he poured the water out onto his hands. From the bowl, he poured it onto his hands. أَكْثَأَ عَلَى يَدَيْهِ مِنَ التَّوْرِ. Similar like with men. So, before he put his hands in there, what did he do? أَفْرَغَ عَلَى يَدَيْهِ. نعم, أَفْرَغَ عَلَى يَدَيْهِ. Here, أَكْفَلَ. أو أَكْفَأَ. Excuse me. عَلَى يَدَيْهِ مِنَ التَّوْرِ. فَغَسَلَ يَدَيْهِ ثَلَاثًا. Just like Uthman. رضي الله عنه. فَغَسَلَ يَدَيْهِ ثَلَاثًا. He washed his hands three times. This hadith of Abdullah ibn Zayd. Huh? What is this ruling here? Sunnah. Just like in the hadith of Uthman. This one is sunnah. ثم أدخل يده في التو. Then he put his hand in the vessel. And the hadith of Uthman, we know which hand that was. Huh? Al-Yamin. Al-Yamin. فمضمض واستنشق واستنثر ثلاثا. We have a ziyadi here. There's an extra benefit here. And this is a very beautiful point that ulama, they mentioned how a person, the people of the sunnah, they arrive to the truth. And how the truth is clarified for the people of Ahl Sunnati wal Jama'ah. They have the clear proof and evidence and truth is clear in front of them because they understand all of the text as one text. All of the text with regards to a particular issue, like for example this issue here of al-wudu. They don't understand it by just looking in the Quran, the verse of wudu. They don't understand it just only the verse, the hadith of Uthman radiallahu anhu. Rather, all of the narrations with regards to the issue of wudu, they gather them all and then they understand from these gathered texts the proper methodology and way. This is with regards to the entire deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with regards to the pillars of Iman, with regards to the pillars of Islam, with regards to transactions. The ulama of the sunnah, the people of the sunnah, they gather the evidences. And one issue, and they look at all of the evidence as one text, like this. The people who use one part and leave off another, then they will be led astray. They will not be able to arrive to the truth. And this is from the reasons why the Khawarij, they went to astray. Because they only look at the text where there are threats, threats of punishment. And also, this is why the Murji'ah, they went astray. Because they only look at the text of the promise of paradise and forgiveness. As for the people of the Sunnah, they look at all of the text and they fear Allah Azza wa Jalla, but hope for His punishment. And they're in the middle, and they're astaghfirullah. They fear They fear the punishment of Allah Azza wa Jal, and they hope for His mercy. They fear the punishment of Allah Azza wa Jal, and they hope for His mercy. The people of the Sunnah and the middle course. Naam, in the middle course. So here we see the same issue. We understand how to make wudu from the wudu of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam by gathering the text. By gathering the text, they explain one another. The ulama, they say, "Al-nusus yufasiru ba'duha ba'dhan, wal ahadith tufasiru ba'duha ba'dhan." That the text, they explain one another. They bring detail to one another. We find the detail from one narration into another narration, or the Quran verses, one verse will explain another verse, or the Sunnah will explain a verse, or one hadith will explain another hadith, like we have in this example here. Like we have in this example here, فَمَضْمَضَ وَاسْتَنْشَقَ وَاسْتَنْثَرَ ثَلَاثًا. He made the مَضْمَضَ وَالْمَضْمَضَ وَالْاسْتِنْشَقَ وَالْاسْتِنْثَرَ ثَلَاثًا. Three times. The first time is obligatory. The other two times are sunnah, is preferred. Naam. Then he says, also clarifying how that was, بِثَلَاثِ غَرْفَاتٍ. بِثَلَاثِ غَرْفَاتٍ أو غَرَفَاتٍ. نعم he made يعني فمضمض واستنشق واستنثر ثلاثا بثلاث غرفات. He made the مضمض and the استنشق واستنثر three times with three handfuls of water. How is that? All three of them, he put it in his mouth and his nose, and he brought it out of his nose and out of his mouth with three times with three handfuls of water. So that means how did he do it? Each handful, he split one handful. Huh? One handful goes in, is split for the mouth and the nose. Each handful, he puts a handful of water, part of it in the mouth and part of it in the nose. This is how he did it, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. This is in the description here. Now I'm clarifying how it was done. So that means that from one handful, part of the water goes in his mouth, the other part goes in his nose, and then he brings it out of his nose and out of his mouth. And out of his nose and out of his mouth. This is one time. That one's obligatory. After that, one more handful, the same thing. One more handful, the same thing. This is the meaning of the narration here. فَمَضْمَضَ وَاسْتَنْشَقَ وَاسْتَنْثَرَ ثَلَاثٍ بِثَلَاثِ غَرْفَاتٍ بِثَلَاثِ غَرْفَاتٍ. He did all of this. أَلْمَضْمَضَ وَاسْتَنْشَقَ وَاسْتَنْثَرَ three times with three handfuls of water. Now, this is the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The ulama, they have mentioned, it's permissible though to use six handfuls of water. Which would be three times for the mouth and three times for the nose. That's permissible, and the wudu would be correct. If he took three handfuls separately for the mouth and three separate handfuls for the nose. That's how many handfuls? Six. This is also permissible. And the wudu would be considered correct. But it's best to try to follow the sunnah if it's possible. This the sunnah described right here, three handfuls with three. Three times with three handfuls of water. Then he said here, رحمه الله ثم أدخل يده فغسل وجهه ثلاثا. And then he put his hand in the water and he washed his face three times. ثم أدخل يده فغسل يديه مرتين إلى المرفقين. And then he put his hands in the water, or he washed his hands to his elbows two times. Naam, what, there's a difference here, sah? How many times did he do that in the hadith? Did Uthman do it? ثم غسل وجهه ثلاثا ثم يديه إلى المرفقين ثلاثا هنا مرتين مرتين. So we see here, Abdullah ibn Zayd, how many times did he wash his face? رضي الله عنه. Three times. Then he washed his arms two times. We see this permissible for a believer to wash one part three times and one part less than that, two times or one time, like this. This is also sufficient. If a believer, he washed his hands all the parts one time, this is good. If he did all of the parts three times, this is the sunnah. Even here, he did some of the parts three times and another part two times. The arms he did two times. رضي الله عنه, this is also permissible. And this is also from the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Likewise, it has come in the hadith of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, Abdullah ibn Abbas radiyallahu anhuma, that it's in Bukhari. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said, tawadda nabi marratan marra. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he made wudu one time, washing each part one time. Now, so then this is to clarify that it's permissible. is permissible. But the majority of the time, the ulama have mentioned that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he would do it three times. He would wash each part three times. He would wash each part three times. But sometimes he did three times, sometimes he did two times. Sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Sometimes he only washed them one time. Naam, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the ulama, they have mentioned that the best one is to wash it three times. Or if one wanted to really apply the sunnah, then the majority of the time that he made wudu, he would make it three times. The sunnah like this. And sometimes he would make it two times. And sometimes even he would make it one time. And you like this. But the majority of the time that he makes wudu, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did, three times. Three times like this. There's an issue and al-qawa'id al-fiqhiyya. And it is about tazahum and masalih. If there's two opportunity, if there's an opportunity to do two things that are beneficial, if there's an opportunity to do two things that are good, both of them are good, both of them are from righteous deeds, both of them are pleasing to Allah Azza wa Jal, and one doesn't know which one to do, which one should we do? The one that has the most benefit, the one that has any يقدم على من المصالح, نعم, the one that has the best benefit. I was pondering and thinking about this issue here, and it came to my mind about the fact of either catching takbir, for a person, for example, is coming late to the salat. He's coming a little bit late. He's not late, the imam didn't start yet. He has to make wudu. He comes in the masjid, and in just a few moments, they're going to make the iqamah. So he has the choice. He can either make wudu three times, like the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or catch the takbirat ihram with the jama'ah. Which one? Make wudu one time. Sah? And then in order to catch takbir al-ihram, now because you fulfill the obligation, and then to catch the takbirah with the imam, this is a great reward for this. The fulfilling the obligation on the pillar of Islam, as-salat. So this one occurred in my mind, and I was thinking about this principle. And alhamdulillah, I asked Sheikh Suleiman al-Ruhaili. We went to his masjid one day and we asked him about this. Is this correct? Yani to make wudu, wash the body parts one time, and then in order to catch the takbirat ihram. And when I asked him, his eyes became big and he was like, nah. But he was like, wa yanwi sunnah. But he would intend the sunnah. Not only will he make it one time, but he will intend the sunnah of making it one time. Because from the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is to make the wudu sometimes one time. So then, when the hadith is here, hadith of Abdullah bin Abbas, tawadda marratan marra. So then, in that case, a person, he can get lots of good by understanding the intention, as we mentioned before. By understanding the intention, he's able to intend to make wudu one time. Fulfilling the obligation, intending to follow the sunnah and doing that by sometimes making the wudu one time and then catching takbirat ihram. And then catching takbirat ihram. And so this is a beautiful understanding that he mentioned. Shaykh Suleiman al-Ruhaili, hafidhahullah ta'ala. So then a believer, he will understand these narrations and try to draw near to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with knowledge. Try to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon basira and seek nearness to Allah azza wa jal with knowledge. As we have seen, in Kitab Akhlaq al-Ulama, that the ulama, they mentioned that Zuhri, for example, he mentioned that مَعُبِدَ اللَّهُ بِشَيْءٍ أَوْ بِمِثْلِ الْفِقْهِ فِي الدِّينِ, that Allah has never been worshipped with something like الفِقْه فِي الدِّينِ, meaning the one who is worshipping Allah with fiqh in the deen, he's the one who's really worshipping Allah Azza wa Jal. The one who knows how to worship Allah Azza wa Jal clearly. That's the one who's truly worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As for the one who is worshipping upon ignorance, then maybe he is doing something and it's not even really considered worship. And it's not even considered worship because of his ignorance of the legislation and of the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But to worship Allah azza wa jalla, fiqh in the deen, this is the goal of a believer. Now this is the goal of the believer, and this is a sign that Allah wants good for him. This is a sign that Allah wants good for him. Hadith. A sign that Allah wants good for him, that he worship Allah with fiqh in the deen. Man yuridillah. Ah. Catch you off guard. مَنْ يُرِيدِ اللَّهُ بِهِ خَيْرٌ يُفَقْهُ فِي الدِّينِ. نَعْمْ. Whoever Allah wants good for, He give him understanding in the religion. Barakallah fikum. Barakallah fikum. نَعْمْ. So, then he mentioned here, three times. ثُمَّ أَدْخَلَ يَدُهُ فَغَسَلَ وَجْهُهُ ثَلَاثًا. Then he put his hands in and he washed his face three times. ثم أدخل يده فغسل يديه مرتين مرتين إلى مرفقين. Two times for the arms here. So this indicates that it's permissible to wash some body parts three times, and some parts two times, or even one time. Even it's been narrated from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he only washed all of the body parts one time. Then he says, ثم أدخل يده فمسح رأسه. Then he put his hands in, and then he wiped his head. Here also a great benefit in this narration, he mentions how he wiped the head. He mentioned that here's the kayfiyah and the description of how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wiped his head. He said, ثُمَّ أَدْخَلَ يَدَهُ أي فِي الْإِنَا فَمَسَحَ رَأْسَهُ فَأَقْبَلَ بِهِمَا وَأَدْبَرَ مَرَّةً وَاحِدَةً. نعم, فَأَقْبَلَ بِهِمَا وَأَدْبَرَ مَرَّةً وَاحِدَةً. نعم, أَقْبَلَ بِهِمَا وَأَدْبَرَ. ثم غسل رجليه, and then he washed his two feet. فأقبل بهما وأدبر. This wording here is explained in the next part. He says, وفي رواية, the author he mentioned, عبد الغني, الحافظ عبد الغني رحمه الله, وفي رواية, and one narration, بدأ بمقدم رأسه حتى ذهب بهما إلى قفاه. Now بدأ, what does it mean? فأقبل بهما وأدبر. Somebody may understand, what does it mean, أقبل? In the Arabic language, أقبل. Which way? أقبل. أقبل, like this. أقبل, الأقبل, in الذهاب إلى المام, صح? So then, how would you understand that? أقبل بهما وأدبر. صح? That's what, أقبل بهما, أقبل means to go to the front, and أدبر means to go to the back. صح? Okay, but this, وفي رواية, this is an important understanding here, that he clarified the meaning of that. بدأ بمقدم رأسه, بمقدم رأسه, نعم, حتى ذهب بهما إلى قفاه. القفاه, the back of the head, right here, the back of the neck, on top of the neck. إلى قفاه, ثم ردهما إلى حتى رجع إلى المكان الذي بدأ منه. فبدأ بمقدم رأسه فذهب بهما إلى قفاه, ثم ردهما إلى المكان الذي بدأ منه. Like this. Now that he took him, he began with the front of his head. رضي الله عنه, and he went to the back of his head like this, and then he brought him back to the place that he started. Now, so that's the meaning of أَقْبَلَ بِهِمَا وَأَدْبَرَ. And then also there's a benefit, يعني الصرفية, الفائدة الصرفية in this, and that is أَقْبَلَ بِهِ أَقْبَلَ وَأَدْبَرَ على أي وزن. أَقْبَلَ أَفْعَلَ. هذه الأوزان لها معاني, لها معاني الأوزان المزيد فيها لها معاني كثيرة. مثلا أفعل, that wasn has many meanings. From هذا تعدية, جلست في المسجد وأجلست الولدة بجواري, like this, that's تعدية. It has many meanings. Also has the meaning of يعني وجود الصفة, just this one scale. أفعل وأكبرناه. أكبرناه, what does that mean, huh? رأينه كبيرا, يعني وجدناه كبيرا. So this has the meaning of they found the sifa, that he's great. They found him to be great. That's understood from this wazan, af'ala, af'ala. Also from the meanings of the wazan af'ala is ad-dukhul, ad-dukhul fi zaman wal makan, ad-dukhul fi zaman wal makan. Like for example, they say amsara ar-rajul idha dakhala misr, idha dakhala misr amsara, wa idha dakhala al-iraq yuqalu a'raqa. وَأَشْأَمَ إِذَا دَخَلَ الشَّمْ. Like this. So it has the meaning of entering into a place. Entering into a place. نعم, entering into a place. Also, in a direction likewise. اتِّجَاءَ إِلَى جِهَةٍ أَشْأَمَ أَشْمَلَ أَفْوًا أَشْمَلَ وَأَجْنَبَ. يعني ذهب إلى الشمال, ذهب إلى الشمال, أو ذهب إلى الجنوب, الشمال, excuse me, أو الجنوب, like this. So these scales, they have meanings. These skills, they have meanings. One of them, of this meeting here, is to go into a place. So then the understanding of this word, أَقْبَلَ بِهِمَا, يعني فَبَدَأَ بِمَقَدَّمِ رَأْسِهِ, يعني أَقْبَلَ بِهِمَا أي أَدْخَلَهُمَا فِي قُبْرِ رَأْسِهِ. المكان هذا القبل. ثم أَدْبَرَ بِهِمَا أي أَدْخَلَهُمَا فِي دُبْرِ الرَّأْسِ, في دُبْر الرَّأْسِ. أَقْبَلَ بِهِمَا وَأَدْبَرَ. أَقْبَلَ بِهِمَا وَأَدْبَرَ. Now that he put his hands in the front of his head, and then he went to the back. And then he brought them back like this, into the back of his head, like this. And some of the ulama, they mentioned, they had maybe trying to understand this narration, they mentioned the one who narrated the hadith, he narrated from behind. فَأَكْبَلَ بِهِمَا وَأَدْبَرَ. For the one from behind, he thinking that he made, he أَكْبَلَ. But this understanding of, in the sarf, this is a beautiful understanding of the ulama, they mentioned, yani أَكْبَلَ بِهِمَا أَدْقَلَ يَدَيْهِ فِي قُبْرِ رَأْسِهِ فِي الْأَمَامِ ثُمَّ أَدْبَرَ بِهِمَا أَيْ أَدْقَلُهُمَا فِي الدُّبْرِ, like this. And the other, in any case, the narration بَدَأَ بِمُقَدَّمِ رَأْسِهِ, this explains the methodology. The ulama, they mentioned that there's two ways to understand that narration. That he began and he أَكْبَرَ بِهِمَا وَأَدْبَرَ, or that he began in the middle, in the front of his head. This is the way to do it, like this. In the front of the head, to the back, and then put it back to the front. And then after this, what about this? Some people do that, huh? What's that part? Huh? هذا مردودٌ عليه. That part, wiping the back of the nape. Huh? That one is not from the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Now some of the ulama, they mentioned that he starts in the middle of the head. فَأَقْبَلَ بِهِمَا وَأَدْبَرَ ثُمَّ رَدَّهُمْ إِلَى مَكَانَ لِبَدَمٍ. So that's another understanding. He started like this, and he went here, and then brought him back to the place that he started. The place that he started. But Allah knows best. What is correct is from the beginning to the back, and then to the beginning. One time. This is not considered one time here and then one time. So some people may think that you do it two times. Sah? No, this is all one time. Some of the ulama, they mentioned the wisdom behind that, akramukum Allah, is that on the first time going back, you get this side of the hair, and then going this way, you get the other side of the hair. When you push it this way, this side of the hair gets white. When you come back the other way, the other side of the hair gets white. In any case, this is one time. This is one time. What if somebody, he wiped like just this part? Or if he just wiped like this? Or part of his head. The whole head or part of the head? What's the wajib? I know we want to talk about the furud of wudu. The furud of wudu is to wipe the whole head. To wipe the whole head. The ulama, they differed about that. But what is correct is the whole head must be wiped. The whole head must be wiped. Ibn Al-Qayyim, he mentioned, rahimahullah ta'ala, لَمْ يَسِحَّ فِي حَدِيثٍ وَاحِدٍ أَنَّهُ اَكْتَصَرَ عَلَى مَسْحِ بَعْضِ رَأْسِهِ أَلْبَتَّ. Ibn Qayyim, he mentioned that it's never been authenticated on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that he ever wiped part of his head. Ever. It's not authentic in any manner that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he ever sufficed with wiping part of his head. Part of his head. So then the sunnah would be to do it like this. To go from the beginning to the back and then to the front. If somebody just did it like this one time, is it sufficient? He wiped the whole head one time. It's sufficient. The ulama, they say, as long as he wiped his whole head. As long as he wiped his whole, he went like this even. It would be correct. But he didn't follow the sunnah. He didn't follow the sunnah. The sunnah is as found here in the hadith of Abdullah ibn Zayd radiallahu anhu, that he would start in the beginning of his head and go to the back. And then he would bring them back to the place where he began in the front. Naam, but as long as the whole head is washed, then the obligation will be performed. The whole head is wiped, then the obligation will be performed. Will be performed, and Allah knows best. Naam, so then he says, وفي رواية أتانا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فأخرجنا له ماء من تور من سفر فأخرجنا له ماء في تور من سفر. In one narration it's mentioned Abdullah ibn Zayd, he's saying that at one time we came to the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم and we brought him a vessel made from sufr. They say sufr is a type of nuhas, like a type of copper or brass. The vessel was made from this. So this is a permissibility to make wudu in this type of a vessel. The types of vessels that are not permissible to make wudu with are the ones that are made from gold or from silver. That are made from gold or silver. Now, but other than that, from the ores and the likes, it's permissible. He says, At-tawru, the author, he mentioned to clarify the meaning, At-tawru shibhu at-tast. Meaning a shibhu is similar to a tast, which was known to the ulama. It's a small vessel. It's a small vessel. Now, it's a small vessel. So this is the complete wudu of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. This is the complete wudu of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. When would it be obligatory to make wudu? For prayer. If a person, he wants to stand for prayer. Now, it's obligatory to make wudu if he wants to stand for prayer. The proof? Now the first hadith, hadith Abi Huraira. Before that, the ayah. If the kumtum ila salati faqsilu al ayah. If you stand, if you intend to stand for prayer, and then make wudu. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, لا يقبل الله صلاة أحدكم إذا أحدث حتى يتوضأ. So the prayer is not accepted except with wudu. Another time, obligatory. We want to talk about obligatory. To make wudu. To recite the Quran. Now many of the ulama they mentioned that. Now. لا يمس القرآن إلا طاهر. حديث عمر بن حزم رضي الله عنه. نعم لا يمس القرآن إلا طاهر. Many of the ulama they mentioned that, that no one touched the Quran except for طاهر, a person upon tahara. نعم, one more time. نعم. Excuse me. Major impurity. صح. You have to make if you have to remove that, but it wouldn't be obligatory. He could wait. Although it's preferred to remove it. But when would it be? He has to make wudu. He has to make tahara. Umrah. When? Tawaf. Ahsan. Tawaf. Naam. Many of the ulama, they mentioned that. The ulama differed about this issue too. Shaykh Abdul Muslim, Hafidhullah, he mentioned this is obligatory to have wudu. And the tawaf. This is it's an obligation. So these are three places that a believer, he is required. If he wants to embark on these affairs, he has to have wudu. He has to have wudu. Naam, this is an obligation. Taib, when is it preferred to have wudu? It's not obligatory, but it's preferred. Before going to bed. Sah. Naam, before going to bed. Naam, also?
Anytime.
What do you mean by that, anytime?
If you have the right intentions, you can stand for purification.
Anytime, meaning every time one breaks the wudu. Every time one breaks the wudu, sah. This is also a time. Also, here we have in the hadith of Al-Bara ibn Azim. He said, "Radiyallahu anhu, إذا أتيت ملجأك فتوضأ وضوءك للصلاة." It's muttafaqun alayh. Hadith Al-Bara ibn Azim, radiyallahu anhu, he said, "إذا أتيت ملجأك." If you come to your bed, فتوضأ وضوءك للصلاة. Make the wudu. Make your wudu for salat. If you want to go to bed, any meaning before you want to go to bed, make the wudu that you make for salat. So it's from the sunnah and it's highly recommended to sleep upon wudu. To make tahara, to make wudu before going to sleep. Naam, before going to sleep. The other time, kul hadith, naam, with evidence here also. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, لن يحافظ على الوضوء إلا مؤمن. No one maintains and preserves the wudu except for a believer. Except for a believer. Likewise, has been narrated from Bilal رضي الله عنه that he said, ما أصابني حدث قط إلا تواضعت عنده. إلا تواضعت عنده. That I have never a hadith. يعني I never invalidated my wudu, or my wudu was never broken except for I made wudu. I made wudu at that time. So also it's recommended for a believer to be upon tahara. It's recommended that if a person, he, for example, akramukum Allah, he used the restroom, after that he make wudu. Even if he's not going to pray. Even if he's not going to pray. Naam? Or even if he's not going to make tawaf. Or even if he's not going to recite the Quran or hold the mushaf. To hold the mushaf. Whenever we talk about the issue of the mushaf, what do we say? Reciting the Quran or holding the Quran? Touching the Quran. No, reciting the Quran, you can recite the Quran without wudu. We want to clarify that. Now, you can recite, a person who does not have wudu, if it's a minor impurity, al-hadith, al-asghar, then he can recite the Quran. But he shouldn't touch the mushaf. Except if he has gloves on, for example, or something between him and the mushaf. Now, this is what the ulama, they mentioned. But as for reciting the Quran while he's in the state of al-hadith, al-asghar, this is permissible. This is permissible. Naam. Also, if the person is in a state of janab and he wants to eat, or he wants to drink, or the likes like this, then it's recommended for him to make wudu. And if he did it, wasn't going to make ghusl, he'll make wudu. He'll make wudu. It's come in the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
The sunnah was also when he used to go back to his family. Used to make wudu first.
Ayah al-Mu'awada. Naam. Also, that's right. And Hadith Abi Sa'id, that if he wanted to have relations the second time, he will make wudu. Ahsant. Jazakallah khairan. One issue we did not discuss with regards to al-wudu, it comes even before washing the hands. What is that issue? Before even beginning. Huh? Huh? We discussed that one. We haven't talked about it yet. We didn't discuss yet. Huh? Al-basma, aywa, al-tasmiyah. 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 The ulama, they mentioned that the issue of al-tasmiyah and saying bismillah before making wudu. And the majority of the scholars, they mentioned that it's sunnah. They mentioned that it's sunnah, it's not obligatory. Based upon that opinion or position, the majority of the scholars from Malik, before that, Malik and Shafi and Abi Hanifa, then if he didn't say the basmalah, or excuse me, if he didn't make the tasmiyah, say bismillah, then his wudu would be correct. But Imam Ahmed, rahimahullah ta'ala, he finds it to be obligatory. He finds it to be obligatory. The Hanabila, they say, yani wajib inda dhikr. Inda dhikr. Wa taskutu bin nisyan. That it's an obligation for the one who remembers. And if he forgot, it falls off. If he forgot, it falls off. And Allah knows best, believer, he should not try to leave it. He should not try to leave it. Before he starts the wudu, he should say, Bismillah. Bismillah. Taib, maybe I'm going to ask the question you want to ask. What about, for example, in the situations that we have now, whenever a lot of the times the bathroom or the akramakum Allah, the place for relieving oneself, is in the same place as the sink where one makes wudu? Say it to yourself. Naam. Sheikh Ibn Baz, he mentioned that you still say it. You still say it. Even you say it quietly because but to yourself, one thing about the adhkar, or the recitation of the Quran, or the adhkar, that they have to be, the lips have to move. So saying it to yourself, if he means like in his heart he said it, like right now I just said Bismillah, but the lips don't move, this doesn't count. Likewise, tasbih, you can't sit there and be like, and he's not moving his lips, in his mind he's saying Subhanallah, Subhanallah, or the light, or his mind, he's reading the Quran, for example, but his lips are not moving. But he's reading though, this is not considered qira'ah. Naam, this is not the one that has the reward that is mentioned. And the hadith of Abdullah bin Mas'ud, the lips have to move. So if a person, even if he was in this situation, he would say he would make the tasmiyah. Shaykh ibn Baz, he mentioned that. Yani because some of the ulama, like Imam Ahmad, he mentioned it's an obligation. It's an obligation. So a believer, he will remember the name of Allah Azza wa Jalla.
On the same point, there's a narration that says there's no wudu without bismillah and there's no salah without wudu. Where is that coming from?
I don't remember right now the narration. There's a narration, Tahara Miftahu Salat, but I don't remember the authenticity of it at this moment. Naam. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta. Astaghfiruka.